Yeah, with regard to the release from the NBA regarding KP's situation, we've addressed it internally. We obviously accept the league's ruling slash statement, and other than that, we have no comment on the matter, other than to get ready to play game two.
Okay, Brad?
Yes, Brad Townsend, Dallas Morning News. Do you know Maxey's status for tonight? And if he is able to play, will he be on any kind of restriction?
My expectation is that he's going to play. I have not, I should say, Casey has not talked to me about any restriction, but these situations, you know, are all ones that require communication. You know, you got to see with your eyes during the game, et cetera, et cetera. Game one, he did fine. Last couple of days, there's been some soreness, but he's been a little better each day, so I believe that he will play tonight.
Okay, Mark Falwell.
Hi, Rick. Mark Falwell, Mavericks TV broadcast. A follow-up about Maxey. Could you share with us what it is about his defensive skill set, his defensive acumen, that you feel like makes him such your best choice in terms of matching up over the course of the game with Kawhi?
Well, his size, length, ability to move his feet, those things make him a unique defender in this league. And look, there are very few guys that have his size, length, quickness, ability to guard multiple positions that can also protect the rim. So he's a very unique player on the defensive side of the ball. And offensively, you know, he's just done his job extremely well this year. You know, he's a movement guy. He makes open shots. You know, he passes the ball, he rebounds the ball, and plays the right way. So he's obviously a very valuable player for us.
Dwayne.
Yes, Rick. Today is the 1-year anniversary of George Floyd's murder. Could you tell me in what way over the last year has the NBA been a catalyst for social justice?
Well, we've seen so many things. You know, on the heels of that, it's been well documented, the story about the NBA head coaches mobilizing and starting coaches for racial justice, and all the things that all the head coaches have done, not only in their own markets with local grassroots organizations, but also with the Obama Foundation on a national level, with Noble on the national level. And, you know, everything that happened in the bubble, you know, had a real sort of really geared toward the fight for racial justice, and it was universal. You know, it was players, coaches, support staff, owners, media, and it was really, really an amazing experience on that level. And you know, we went through the Jacob Blake situation, Kenosha, where some games were canceled. The players got together and decided, you know, whether to continue to play, all those kinds of things. And out of that came an agreement with the owners to really make an emphasis from that point forward on voting rights and attacking voter suppression, and to make as many NBA arenas available as voting centers as possible. And at that point in time, there were 8 NBA arenas that were certified. A lot of NBA teams were getting stonewalled by their local counties to do so. But after that day going forward, when the election came in November, 22 out of 30 had been certified. And there was obviously a big swing in the vote. And the NBA and the NBA players had a lot to do with that. And that's tied into social justice also in a big way. So there have been many events. Our awareness as a society has increased. I wouldn't even know how many fold in terms of awareness but I would have to say exponentially. And so much good has happened, but obviously the work goes on.
Mark Medina.
Hey, Rick, I got a basketball question here on Porzingis. What's your analysis so far of what his chemistry is like with Luka? What do you see, big picture, of what that tandem can become?
I see it constantly evolving in a positive way. And the bottom line is, the more they've been on the court together, the more their chemistry is enhanced. And so, you know, heading into game two, which will really be, if you count the three games KP played last year, you know, this will be their, I think, their fifth playoff game together. You know, it's going to keep building from here.
Okay, last one will be Law.
Law Murray, The Athletic. Last 2 years, the team's been one of the best teams in the league at protecting the basketball as far as turnovers per possession. That's despite the fact that everyone knows who has the ball in their hands all game, Luka. Like, how have you been able to foster that kind of offensive structure over the last couple of years, where even though you know Luka's going to have the ball as much, the whole team does a great job of just not turning the ball over?
Yeah, it's an emphasis of ours. And our two guards, you know, Luka and Jalen Brunson, you know, both are experienced. They both understand the value of ball security. And they both have a natural, you know, tendency to do that well. We've been fortunate. You know, I've been here many, many years, and we, for the most part, we've had teams that take very good care of the ball. Tonight will be an enhanced challenge. You know, beginning of game two, their intensity level will be picked up for sure. Their physicality will be picked up for sure. And we're going to have really great offensive energy, intensity, and recognition to make sure that we can take care of the ball the way we need to.